All right. So, Ed, what's your reaction to these numbers? I mean, where do you think is the market right now, and where do you think it's headed?
We're at a two-year low, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. Mainly foreign selling. I guess the bright spots really are the fact that the locals are still buying from institutional to retail. Mm-hmm. They know that it's bargain buys because we're cheaper than we were pre-pandemic already, I think. So it's, except the only concern there is that if U.S. interest rates go up again and then we don't match it, peso will depreciate, so it will, you know, their interest. It's really sentiment. But in terms of value, we're really cheap already.
Mm-hmm. But Ed, you know, some people are waiting for this knife to fall further. What do you think? How low can we go?
It's possible it can still go further down. Because again, we're affected by global events. If it was just domestic, we should be very stable. So we just have to be very selective in our investments and in how we use money. But at the same time, we should still consume, because otherwise that will also just spiral downwards further.
You talk about the peso, Ed. What's the real score? How high, in our case, how weak do you expect the peso to go? You did say that... It all depends on how the Fed, you know, how long the Fed will keep raising rates, and the expectation it's still going to be until next year.
Yeah, in fact, because even if we're growing at 6.5%, but then, and if our inflation mm-hmm. is around 6.3, 6.4, the government monetary board might still increase rates a little bit. We would not be surprised if they do an off-cycle increase, again, only because if the Fed FOMC will increase in November. And if that happens, then you're right, that the peso might depreciate further, hopefully not as much, again, because it's Christmas season. I hope it will not touch 60, but if it touches it, I hope it doesn't deteriorate further, because it will also be more expensive for a lot of the goods.
Mm-hmm. So what are you telling investors now, Ed? They're probably feeling panicky and nervous and a lot of jitters.
Yeah, again, it's a good thing we have investors who have balanced funds. Mm-hmm. Those already have a fixed rate, corporate bonds. That's okay, because at least they're giving good yields. For those who are in equities, we're telling them to invest selectively. There are still some good buys, Mimi. Mm-hmm. And you can be very defensive. The fact that we are one of the highest GDP growth targets for the next 2 years, once things get settled down, maybe hopefully in the next few months, then these stocks will significantly go up and you'll have a lot of upside. But just be prepared for it to go sideways or even go down a little bit more. Just tighten your belts.
What about the deals flows, Ed? You work on so many of these deals. What are you hearing from these companies who are about to go public? A few more to go for the rest of the year. Are they starting to feel nervous, maybe thinking about backing out or delaying these debuts?
Okay, let me answer it two ways. One, on the equity side, we continue to work on a lot of deals. And sometimes it's just a matter of postponing it, because if these are good companies anyway, maybe the market might be closed today or they might not get the valuation they like. We can postpone it and try again in a few months. Because if they're great stories, then there'll be always be appetite for them. It's a matter of pricing. Mm-hmm. For the bond deals anyway, as you know, that the PDEX is already reaching almost 400 billion. So it's a record year. You know, about the San Miguel 60 billion bond. People are still looking for fixed rate investments anyway, corporate bonds, because those give better yields. So we don't see a slowdown there. Despite rates going up, in fact, maybe because rates might stabilize, it's good to lock in also on your long-term investments.
All right. Ed, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. You're from the banking, but I wanted to get your take on a merger involving your competitor, of course, BPI and Robinsons Bank. They're going to be merging to bring together what they say would be the innovativeness of the Robinsons Group and the scale and breadth of BPI. It's going to give BPI access to the digital bank GoTime as well. How should investors take this news? Surprising or bound to happen?
Yes. No, I see it as very positive anyway. Mm-hmm. BPI is a competitor, but, you know, they're a group that we really respect a lot anyway. And, mm-hmm. the families are close anyway. It's very good for them. Great move for TG Lim Ng Kakko and his team. They were not able to get Citibank's retail.
Yes.
But I know they were very competitive. It was just some of the other non-financial issues. So this one will be a good mix. Rubina also was gushing, I guess, working with the new group also.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a win-win for them. It should be easier for them to adjust anyway to the culture of BPI. BPI is very professional. So I think it will be good, and good also for the consumers, because I guess Lance has a lot on his plate. So banking was not really there. They didn't put as much assets anywhere or as much time, mm-hmm. I guess. So teaming up with the Ayalas is a good move from their perspective.
All right. How about this? From banking to the property sector, Injap Sia and Tony Tankakyong's Double Dragon expected to take a hit from a possible POGO ban. Apparently, POGOs account for 65% of their REIT.
Right. I guess among the REITs, they're the only one with REIT exposure.
Mm-hmm.
When they listed anyway, they disclosed that, but that was a vulnerability. So you're right. Now that if POGOs are banned, then they will get a big hit. I'm just hoping that, I guess with the brilliance of Edgar, that we will find attractive other investments to take, I guess, to compensate for the loss of the POGO. Because otherwise, it will hit their P&L and hit their dividend rates effectively for the near term. But I'm hopeful anyway that with Edgar Injap's creativity and business savvy, I think I saw some announcements already on overseas investments, that he'll replace the lost POGO revenue.
Hopefully. Ed, could you help us connect the dots? Are rising interest rates generally good for REITs?
Rising interest rates, in fact, no, are not good for REITs. Because
if
interest rates rise, that means investors will have alternative investments because they buy REITs maybe for more as a fixed income.
Mm.
So therefore, the prices are supposed to go down in theory because on REIT anyway, you cannot immediately just pass on the increase or ask for higher rent. So it should be negative. But that's why at least if some of the other REITs with longer runways, no, when we're talking about even Vistalan, Mega World, they have great other projects. So that will help compensate and that will help bring in additional growth also.
All right. And we have this. Maynilad and Manila Water are expected to start hiking rates in 2023 as the mighty dollar continues its ascent. This is for the foreign currency differential that they get from consumers. Meralco encouraging more firms to join the interruptible load program. They're saying the initiative has about 582 megawatts from 121 companies who are helping them keep the lights on for everyone when there is a shortage. Cebu Pacific also looking to add more flights from Davao and Cebu starting next month. They're looking to boost the non-Manila flight network by 35%. Ed, are you starting to like airlines? Or not yet?
Yeah, no, yes. The load factors are up. It's mm-hmm. hard to get flights, right? Again, because of all this travel, even internally and even outside, we're able to travel already. In fact, right? Some of our friends went to Singapore to watch the F1, right?
So, I know. So, I was thinking maybe you were there.
I was hoping to go, but I wasn't able to get tickets anyway. But that's fine. I'll try to go next year. But no, it's good. The various news you said, from airlines to the capex of Meralco, or Meralco's trying to divvy up finite resources or the tests,
mm-hmm.
and even for the water companies, shows that the economy is picking up.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe in a way it shows that CapEx should expand again because we're reaching limits already or capacity constraints. So that will do well for more the banks also because it means more loans to fund their growth.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a little harder now for the consumer, admittedly, because it's harder, right? Electricity might get higher, water might get higher. So those are the utilities. Gasoline has been going up. So we just have to really... hopefully work through this together. And a lot of the corporates, my clients, when I ask them anyway, they really are not passing the full cost increases to the clients. You know, mm-hmm. when I talk to, for example, friends like June O'Malley of Gardenia, John Lucoa of the bakeries, you know, they cannot pass on. They're trying to keep it also I guess, affordable to the customer. Mm. So that's a key that what it's a private partnership between the large and the medium. We're helping the consumers too.
Yeah, but for how long though, Ed? Because the BSP is warning, you know, inflation is going to go up further for the month of September. In fact, it's they're saying that more expensive electricity, food, and the weaker peso may have pushed Philippine September inflation higher to within 6.6 to 7.4%. When you hear news about this, what are your expectations for earnings then? Are you looking at earnings downgrade revisions?
We've already been adjusting earnings projections, yes. Admittedly, our corporates have been adjusting. If they haven't adjusted their revenue targets because of slower demand, in as the example I said earlier, they try to maintain their revenues, the sales targets, but they're not passing on the increases, the cost increases, so their margins are going down. Mm-hmm. So from a net income perspective, we're seeing a decline. Mm-hmm. It's still growth, but it's a decline.
Yeah.
And then I guess the question, Mimi, is relative to other countries who are in deeper problems, I guess we're still better off. So it's a question of who's in a worse situation.
All right. Ed, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. You like the stock. Don't tell us. Just describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us today?
Okay. I'm now in a defensive mode because I feel that there's a lot of potential downside. This stock went down, was hit recently. The price went down significantly, and I don't understand why. Because they're very, very critical for all of us. We deal with them one way or another. In this segment, anyway, it's really they really just pass on their expenses, their costs, so they should be able to retain it. And it's a scarce resource. So I guess you can judge. But at least they will continue to hopefully have good growth and they're just maximizing whatever they can sell.
All right. What sort of upside can we expect from the share price?
Upside? Well, they're down already almost, 30-40% from their peak. So I was really surprised because I personally also am long in this stock. So I believe in the management. I believe in their prospects and their industry. So I hope they will recover also soon, the stock price, because good for the investors.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. I think you gave it away, but let's see. Thank you so much, Ed. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a good week ahead.
Thank you. Bye-bye, Mimi.
All right, see you soon.